Good morning, students. So welcome to today's online video class. Today it's going to be a different video. Today I thought to show you the important diagrams from Carranza which will help you for your perio theory paper. Okay, and before I start the video, I want to wholeheartedly thank my interns. I work in Sri Anjana Institute of Dental Science, so I want to thank all my interns for making this possible for me. Okay, so let's get to the video. All right, so let's start with the important diagrams. Okay, so the first diagram is the anatomic landmarks of gingiva. Okay, it's there on page number 4 in Carranza's second South Asian edition. All right, so this diagram I had told you when in my previous video. This is the enamel and this is the root surface. Okay, and this V shape inside is your gingival sulcus. Until here, over here, this demarcation is your marginal groove, this portion here is your marginal gingiva. From your marginal groove until your mucogingival junction is your attached gingiva, and then further beyond that is your alveolar mucosa. This is the alveolar bone, and the gingiva is always drawn in this pattern, where this is the epithelial portion and this is the connective tissue portion. So anatomic landmarks of the gingiva, I hope it is clear to you. It is there on page number 4. Now next is junctional epithelium on an erupting tooth. Okay, so this is there on page number 12. This is the enamel portion. Okay, and this is the sulcular epithelium. Now beyond the sulcular epithelium down, this is where the formation of junctional epithelium takes place. This is your reduced enamel epithelium and this is the afibrillar acellular cementum that is there here. Okay, so junctional epithelium on an erupting tooth, page number 12. Now the next important diagram is from the chapter stages of gingivitis. Okay, now these diagrams are there on page number 152. So what is this diagram? This is the enamel portion, this is the root portion, and this is your gingiva. So over here they are stating that as the microbial load increases, okay, there are defense cells like your neutrophils, your monocytes, which are released. Okay, now the second diagram is about the next stage, in which there is so much increase of microorganisms that your defense cells are now released into this area, okay, your neutrophils, and there is dilated vessels, vascular proliferation and increased collagen loss over here. Now the next stage is established gingivitis, in which there is more than 30% of plasma cells and there is marked proliferation of your junctional epithelium. See over here, it is smooth, whereas when it comes here, there is proliferation of the epithelium, increased microbial load and increase in the number of cells. Okay, so that was regarding the stages of gingivitis. Now the next important diagram is the plaque bacterial association between tooth surface and the periodontium. So what is this about? See, this is the tooth surface. Okay, you can check my plaque video. I have taught about tooth associated plaque, and over here is the tissue associated plaque. What lies in between over here is the unattached plaque. Okay, then there is some amount of bacteria which is entered into the connective tissue area, and there are some bacteria on the tooth surface. So this diagram is also important. It is on page number 98. Okay, tooth associated plaque, tissue associated plaque, unattached plaque, bacteria within the connective tissue, and bacteria on the bone surface. Now next is the different types of periodontal pocket. This diagram is there on page number 194. So if the pocket is because of the overgrowth of gingiva, it becomes a gingival pocket. If the level of the pocket is above the level of your alveolar bone, it becomes a suprabony pocket. If the level is below the level of your alveolar bone, it becomes an infrabony pocket. Now this diagram is the layers below, okay, on the bottom of the pocket. If suppose this was your tooth surface, this is the calculus over it, and over the calculus there will always be a layer of attached plaque. Then there is a layer of unattached plaque followed by the junctional epithelium, the lysed connective tissue fibers, and then the intact connective tissue fibers. Okay, areas at the bottom of the pocket. Now this diagram is on page number 889. Okay, so this is regarding the Bass method of brushing. According to the Bass method, from the from the tooth surface to your brush would be 45 degrees. Okay, the toothbrush is placed with the bristles angled approximately 45 degree from the tooth surface. Okay, so this is the Bass method, in which some fibers are able to go into your subgingival area. Okay, so that was regarding Bass method. Now this is from the surgical section. This is on page number 502. Okay, this is, so this is excisional new attachment procedure, in which this is the crown portion, this is the gingival portion. Okay, an internal bevel incision is placed to the point bottom of the pocket. Okay, this is the line of incision and this much is removed. Okay, this is there on page number 502 of Carranza. Now the next is P.D. Miller's classification of gingival recession. Okay, this is which means the marginal tissue recession that does not extend to the mucogingival junction. It is until here, so that is grade 1. Grade 2 is when it extends up to the mucogingival junction. Grade 3 is beyond the mucogingival junction and the tooth may be malpositioned. Grade 4 is extends to or beyond the mucogingival junction and there is severe bone and soft tissue loss. Okay, even this is almost the same. This is the narrower version, this is a wider version. Okay, so that is P.D. Miller's classification. Now this is the basic incisions for flap surgery. It is there on page 511. Okay, this is the tooth surface and this is the gingiva. So the first incision will be your internal bevel incision, which is 1 to 2 mm away. Okay, this is the internal bevel incision. The second incision is your sulcular incision or crevicular incision, whereas the third incision is your interdental incision. Okay, so these are the three important incisions when it comes to horizontal incisions. Whereas vertical incisions, this is where not to place a vertical incision, and these are the three correct methods. So they are saying that you should not place the incision right in the center of the interdental papillae. Okay, so when you do that, you tend to split the papillae. So the incision should be made at the line angles to prevent the splitting of the papillae or incising directly over the radicular surface. So you should always place the incision at the line angles and not directly on the papillae and directly on the most radicular surface. This diagram is on page number 512. Next is osseous resection. This is on, okay, so this is regarding so this is the bone loss pattern that is there. Okay, and once this bone loss that is there, okay, this is the moderate periodontitis with interdental crater. Over here are the vertical grooves that are present. If you see steps of resective osseous surgery, the first is vertical grooving, this is radicular blending. Okay, and this is gradualizing the marginal bone. Okay, flattening the interproximal bone is present, and then there is gradualizing the marginal bone. So these diagrams from osseous resective surgery are important. Now the next is pathway of spread of inflammation from the gingiva into the supporting tissues. So this is there on page number 211. Okay. So this is the crown portion of two adjacent teeth. This is the interdental gingiva and this is the root portion. So in this diagram they are saying that the inflammation extends from the interdental area, and in most cases it goes from the interproximal area to the gingiva, from the gingiva to the bone, and then from the bone into your PDL space. So that is this, from the gingiva into the PDL space. Okay, whereas very rarely it goes directly from the gingiva this way into the PDL space. Okay, similarly over here, facial and lingual from the gingiva along the outer periosteum. Okay, here, and once it reaches the outer periosteum, from there it into the bone. Very rarely does it come directly into the PDL and then affect the alveolar bone. Okay. Now the next one is classification of endoperiolesion. So over here you see there is caries, and this is a primary pulpal infection, and then it may progress to the periodontium. Okay. The next type is when there is primarily periodontal infection. So there is periodontal infection, and from accessory canals it is affecting the pulpal area. Alright. Whereas these two diagrams, this is independent endoperiolesion, in which there is caries that is present which is causing its own destruction. Also there is periodontal disease that is present which is causing its own destruction. This is a combined endoperiolesion in which the lesion is combined. Primary pulpal and periodontal infections can occur extensively as combined endoperiolesion, which is there on page number 660. Okay, so the infection is spread from here into the periodontium, and even from the periodontium up to the pulpal area. Okay. Now this diagram is also very important. It is the implant periodontium relationship. This is there on page number 668. Whereas this is the implant. Okay, this is the alveolar bone. This is the crown, in the implant crown. Okay, so the implant, you must remember, it does not have any periodontal ligament. It does not have any cementum. All it has, because there is direct osseointegration between the bone and the implant surface. Okay, but it will have a junctional epithelium, a sulcular epithelium, and an outer epithelium, and certain gingival fibers around. Okay. So that was regarding your implant periodontium relationship. Now this is the angular defects, the different types of angular defects that are seen. It is on page number 216. Now if you check here, this is a one wall defect. Okay, one wall around one side of the tooth is missing. This is a two wall defect. Two walls around the tooth are missing, whereas the other walls are intact. And this is a three-wall vertical defect in which the back wall is missing, the side wall is missing, and the front wall is also missing. So it's a three-wall vertical defect. Okay. Now next diagram is that of subepithelial connective tissue grafting technique, which is there on page number 587. So for example, over here in this much portion, there is no gingiva. Okay. So you will place an incision like this. You will reflect the flap, okay, and then you will place the graft from another area, and then you will suture it back, okay, which will help to cover the area of recession. So this is subepithelial connective tissue grafting technique. Okay, so this graft is a subepithelial graft. All right, so it is on page number 587. Now this diagram is that of hemisection or bicuspidization. So if there is bone loss that is extended up to the furcation area, okay, then what will you do? You have the option to do root canal procedure on the tooth and then cut it into two, and then place independent crowns on it such that it behaves like two premolars. Okay, so this picture is there on page number 568. This is also a very important picture, the principal fibers of the periodontium. This was from Orbins. Okay, so these are the periodontal ligament fibers. Okay, you have the alveolar crestal, horizontal group, oblique group, apical group, interradicular group. Okay, this is the tooth surface, this is the alveolar bone, and these are your fibers. Alright, next is the difference between fenestration and dehiscence. So this is dehiscence, where it's completely denuded of the periosteum. So how I remember is, see this D, D, it's a very lame example, but this is dehiscence. Whereas an isolated area like this, this is called as fenestration. Okay, so these were the important diagrams. Please tell me your feedback regarding this video. And if I'll try to post more videos regarding the important flowcharts and the important studies that are there in Carranza. Okay, thank you.